Detail ye and bring them near. Yea, let them take counsel together. Who has declared this from ancient time? Who has told it from that time? Have not I the Lord? And there is no God else beside me, a just God and a Savior. There is none beside me. Welcome to another No God Else podcast, your host Mario. We are coming to you again with hopefully a small lesson. And a lesson that kind of was, reminded to me when I was watching movies with my son the other day. We were catching Israel up on different movies that I grew up with, either in my late teens or even as an adult, a little bit before he was born. And he's missed out on a lot of different movies. So we've been catching him up on some of the old movies that people have deemed as great or deemed as not so great, but still worth actually watching. You know, we've been catching him up on things like Superman, the older Superman, Christopher Reeves, the Screams, of course. Lord of the Rings series. I mean, we've done all kinds of different series with him. And the latest one that we reviewed was Now You See Me. And that, I don't know if you guys remember that, but that's the magic movie with all the upcoming stars in it. And they were all a part of this group that the all-seeing eye or whatever was recruiting, and they had to perform all of these different tricks, and the group's name was the Four Horsemen. And stemming from the Bible and kind of playing on those words, the four horsemen of the apocalypse, right? That's nothing new, you know. Four Horsemen has been deemed and used whenever somebody wants to establish a group of four, you know, and establish that they have power or whatever. They've always played on that that term found in the Bible. Even wrestlers have done that in WWE, I believe. But anyway, we were watching one of the tricks that they did in the movie, and most of you have seen the movie, you know which one I'm talking about, whether as I start to explain it. But it was the one with the vault, where the money was actually in the vault the whole time, but the people that came there to look at the vault only found the vault empty. And how they did that was mirrors. So they designed mirrors to reflect, and the way they reflect and the angle took place, it made it look like the room was just one empty room, when all in reality what it was that the money was right behind the mirror. And I remember explaining to Israel that mirrors are used in a lot of different illusions, because they can show an angle that necessarily doesn't reflect the angle in which you could duplicate it, you know, such as what you're seeing here. In this mirror here, you're looking at a reflection of a woman praying in the mirror, which I thought was ironic. But that person is facing that person. So if she turned around and mimicked this same exact image, it wouldn't actually reflect the same way. So if her watch was on this side and she turned around and mimicked this image here, this reflection, her watch would be on this side of her arm, on this side of the mirror. And so it got me thinking, you know, mirrors are they reveal who you are, they reveal the reflection of the image in front of it, but you have to be careful, because that image is very trickery. It has a little trickery in it too, because it reverses the sides, you know. So something in your right hand only looks in your right hand as long as you're facing the mirror, but if you turn around and try to mimic the reflection, you'll realize the reflection's it looks like it's in the left hand. So not necessarily in the right hand. So got me thinking about that, you know, like I've seen so many attempts like that in the Word of God, when people try to adapt the Word of God to their lives, right? And people take the Word of God and they apply it. They try to mimic it, right? But over time, what you realize is that these people are not really mimicking the Bible altogether. They're mimicking it up to a certain point. And then when they get up to a certain point, they have to step back and reevaluate whether or not what they're seeing and what they're applying and what they're using and teaching others really reflects or actually duplicates what the Bible says. Because you don't want a reflection of God's word so much as you want a duplication of it. And I know the reflection is always used and played on, you know, but I believe we should be looking for a duplication of God's word, because duplicating it means it's exact. Reflection cannot always be exact. Yes, you're looking at your reflection in the mirror, but in reality, if you look at the image, it can show you something that is not exact in some way or another based on the reflection. Because even in a reflection is not 100% accurate. There's still something about it that is off because it is a reflection, or something about it that is not all the way 100% exactly like the thing that it is reflecting. You know, it's designed to do that. But the fact that it's reflecting means that there's a distortion. A distortion that causes the one-to-one ratio to be off. Even by a small margin, it's still off, right? And it's almost like doing a duplicate, you know, of a copy of another copy, right? So you take a photo, you copy it, you take the copy of the photo that you just made and copy it again, and you take that copy and you copy it again. Well, down the line, you'll start to see a degradation of the same copy, because you're taking the inferior copy and duplicating it again, and then you're taking that inferior copy and duplicating it again. So it got me thinking again, like, how many times have we taken God's word and said, you know what, God's word says you shall not sleep with your neighbor's wife, and we apply it across the board, said you shouldn't sleep with your neighbor's wife, that's adultery, right? But what we'll do is that same neighbor's wife will get on our friend or our neighbor about sleeping with her, but that same neighbor's wife is what we dream about and think about all day long, but we haven't done it. We didn't go out and sleep with her, but we think about it every day. And so we're applying God's word only as it makes us feel comfortable in applying it. See, we can quote God's word all day long. Look, and thus saith the Lord this, and thus saith the Lord that, because whatever we're quoting is something that we're comfortable with, something we either don't have a problem with, or something we've convinced ourselves we don't have a problem with. And we're using that to say, hey, see, I'm teaching God's word, and I'm helping others, and I'm telling you about God's word. But yet, you turn that page, one page over, and bring yourself down to the third paragraph in the next chapter, and it mentions something that we like doing, or it mentions something about us, or it mentions something about our flaws. All of a sudden, that scripture now gets pushed away. We don't want to look at that scripture. You're just being too exact. You're just causing trouble. You just need to focus on the love of Jesus. Oh, wait a minute. I need to focus on the love of Jesus now, because I'm talking about something that you don't like, or something that brings attention to a flaw that you have. But five chapters before, or the chapter before this, when you were quoting God's word to your neighbor about not sleeping with his wife, then it's not just the love of Jesus anymore. Now it's about me showing you that God's word says this, right? And God's word says that, and that's why you should be going by this, okay? But when God's word says this, then you don't want to talk about it. You don't want to apply it to yourself. You don't want to apply it to the mirror, to the image that you're projecting to others. There's a flaw in all of us. Yes, you may not be sleeping with your neighbor's wife, but you're lusting after her. Yes, you may not be stealing from your neighbor, but you're going behind his back gossiping. We all have flaws and we all fall short. However, that does not mean, again, and I want to preface this to say this, that we get to a point also that we believe because we've established that part, that that means that we shouldn't ever talk about sin. You can't tell that person that they're sinning. You can't tell that person that sleeping with their girlfriend or boyfriend is wrong, because you have faults too. That's nothing to do with identifying something that is wrong. If that was the case, then there would be no scripture written in the entire Bible from any disciple or any prophet if that was the case. Anything about sin would be even relevant in the Bible from that point, because every prophet, every disciple sinned. Every one of us had fallen short, even the disciples, everybody but Christ. But yet, still have Paul, still have Mark, Matthew, Luke, John. You know, we have all kinds of disciples that are writing scriptures. And we have all kinds of prophets that are writing scriptures that we go by. And these same prophets, Moses, Abraham, all these prophets of the Old Testament and all the disciples of the New Testament, all mention sin and all warns us to stay away from sin and all identify what sin is. So if they can't tell us what's wrong or when we've sinned or when we shouldn't or what is sin and why it should be eradicated, if they can't tell us simply because they have faults, then how are they able to write the Bible? Through the Holy Spirit, how are they able to write it? Still them. Yes, guided by the Holy Spirit. But still them. Even Paul says, I'm the chief among sinners. But yet Paul still cast judgment on people who were inside of the church causing dissension between the ranks. And even cast them out to Satan for death. There is no higher judgment cast upon anybody than death. And turning them over to Satan. There's no other judgment that Paul, there's no other higher judgment that Paul could ever make against a person than to do that. Well, yet he did. And yet he's chief among all sinners, as he confessed, right? So that proves that just because every person has flaws doesn't mean that person has to shut up to make you feel good about you continuing on doing your sin. Sin is sin, people. Doesn't matter if I'm doing it, you doing it, or anybody else doing it, it's still sin. And to point that sin out is something that we all have a responsibility in doing. Now, you can say, well, what about those who cast the first stone? Okay, those who cast the first stone, their judgment was death. Their judgment was death upon that woman. Not whether or not that she sinned. Not whether or not that she should repent. Not whether or not that she should get better or leave the lifestyle that she led. Their judgment was death, and that is what Christ asked them to do. Those who are without sin cast the first stone. He didn't say those who are without sin can identify her and call her sin out. He didn't say that. He said cast the first stone, because they had made a final judgment. And that is what Christ was talking about. Not whether or not identity of the sin could not be done simply because these people had sinned themselves. No. The identity of whether or not it was a sin was something that was established in God's word and backed up and identified or confirmed through God's people. We are all God's people. We are all cast to have that type of responsibility of identifying within church or within the world what is acceptable in God's eyes based on His word and what is not. It is up to you, and me and the elders of the church to go to those who have sinned and say, look, you need to repent, you need to stop. And if they do not listen, then bring it up again. If they do not listen again, then of course there is another step. There are scriptures that back this up over and over again, how you are to not even have lunch with this person, not even sit down with this person once they have refused counsel of the priest or the minister or the elders of the church. Once you have approached this person, identify this person as they're sinning, and identify to them what the scripture has said, and the elders come and beg and plead for this person to turn away. If they do not, their place is not within the walls of the church to continue to pray, you know, to fellowship with them and being friends with them and encouraging them daily to continue on with their life. Their judgment, the judgment that is passed upon the church, is to isolate them away from the church. It's to say, hey, if you don't change, if you don't do this, if you continue on this, we cannot fellowship with you. That is what the word says for us to do, but in today's society, we want to make believe that that's harsh. Again, mirror image. Look in the mirror. You say, follow God's word. But when it comes to following God's word, you want to pick and choose. You don't want to follow it when it's hard. You don't want to follow it when it accuses you of something. You don't want to follow it when it puts your family in jeopardy, or when it puts your relationship with your loved ones in jeopardy. You don't want to follow it then. Because I bring this up, oh my goodness, what are they going to think of me? What are they going to say to me? If I actually tell them that God's word says that this is a sin, they're going to look at me bad. They're going to get on me. They're going to tell me I'm no better than them and blah, blah, blah. So what? That is your responsibility. Responsibility of the church, responsibility of the elders. It is all of our responsibilities to guard and protect the sanctity of the kingdom of God. That's why Paul spent so much time trying to make sure that people are weeded out that are counterproductive to the word. I mean, to the establishment of the church. Whether it's those who kept sinning without remorse, or whether it was those who were just causing dissension inside of the church walls, or those teaching false doctrines inside of the church walls, all of them had the same destination, and that was to remove them from the church. Until they repent and return, that is the only time they are to be accepted back in. That's what the scriptures teach, guys. It may not be popular, again, but it is what the word teaches us, rather. And we can't sit up there and say, well, so-and-so over here is shacking up with sister so-and-so. How dare he? You know what God's word says, it says against this. Or the pastor stands up and says, you know, you should tithe. You know, God's word said you should tithe and you should give 10% and blah, blah, blah. Okay, you need to do this. You know, this is God's commandments. Okay, this is God's commandments. Now, is God's commandments only about tithing, or only about the subject matter that you're comfortable with? Or is God's commandments across the board, even on the subjects that you don't like talking about, even on the subjects that may cost you tithes, even on the subjects that may cost you memberships? You have to look at yourself in the mirror, all of us, and understand that God's word is a double-edged sword. It cuts both ways, people. When you strike down to follow God's word, it comes back up to strike you. It's double. It's not going to leave you unscathed. If you follow it, you will change. It will cut you. It will bleed you. But it will, for the betterment of you, create a better person if you're following His word. And that is our responsibility. So I hope hope you got something from this one today. It's been a little bit since I made a podcast. I think it's been about 2 or 3 weeks. But I wanted to get this out. So until next time, guys.